Now we'll move to my dear colleague. We will just make a minor shift because my dear colleague, Dr. Ahmed Elbassiouny, he is one of our eminent interventionists. He's having an emergency catheterization, so he will make his presentation now. Dr. Ahmed Elbassiouny is a professor of neurology in Shams University, and he is one of the eminent interventionists, neurointerventionists, and in our department in Shams University. He will present a new update in mechanical thrombectomy for acute ischemic stroke patients. Please, Dr. Ahmed.
Thank you, Dr. Hani, and thank you, Dr. Suhail, and thank you, my dear colleague, Dr. Hussam Salah, and for all the panelists, and for the Medtronic and Boehringer, the Angels Society. I would like to present a small presentation. Actually, I will not give that much scientific lecture, but as you know, Dr. Hani and Dr. Hussam, I would like to be how practical I can give some examples from our daily practice so that we can discuss in the context of the guidelines and the different situations that we can face in our cases. Our introduction that since 2015, the seven mega trials which were done, the very famous trials which showed the superiority of the mechanical thrombectomy in the patients with major vessel occlusion like the MC occlusion, M1 occlusion, or internal carotid artery occlusion. So that in 2015, the American Heart Association and the American Stroke Association guidelines give our their recommendations that it is a class 1A recommendation that any patient with pre-stroke MRS score 0 to 1 and there is an occlusion of the internal carotid artery or the middle cerebral artery segment M1 specifically with an age group above 18 years and NIHSS score above 6 and his aspect above 6. So the treatment can be initiated the groin puncture within 6 hours of the symptom onset. This is the practice all over the world now. And this is the practice, of course, in our university hospitals. And since that time, there was always a debate about the relationship of the IV thrombolysis and the thrombectomy. And many trials are going on in this context to show some with thrombolysis and thrombectomy, the bridging technique, and the others are against. But until now, the guidelines are clear. The patients who are eligible for IV alteplase should receive the IV alteplase even if endovascular therapy are being considered, and this is a class 1A. And actually speaking, this is our practice and our guidelines in our university hospital. And I can say by experience, we are doing pretty many cases now of mechanical thrombectomy that it facilitates for a big extent the mechanical thrombectomy procedure. The other guideline, which is clear, which is class 3, which means it's harmful, that the patient under consideration for mechanical thrombectomy should not wait for the IV alteplase to recanalize the artery. Because this percentage is not more than 10 to 12%. And so in most of the cases, we should proceed for the mechanical thrombectomy after IV alteplase. And this is also our practice. Although we see some cases when we are, for a reason or not, we are late in the thrombectomy, we find that the arteries sometimes are recanalized with just only the IV alteplase. But this is not the common practice, everyday practice. I will show some difficult scenarios we are facing. But not all the cases are just straightforward cases. I will show some. They are not rare, but they are everyday practice. But we don't have answers till now for these situations. This is a case of 52 years old female patient which have a sudden AF when the right MC occlusion. We can see here the basal ganglia infarction, Abak and the Sylvian infarction. And the patient is having M1 occlusion, which is confirmed by the magnetic resonance angiography. We went for the angiosuit, Abak, and Abak we did, we confirmed the presence of the M1 occlusion. We started with the aspiration, Abak, and the stent retrieval, Abak, and we succeeded to recanalize Abak the artery. But during the procedure, I found something which is strange, Abak, that Abak, we have the anterior cerebral artery occlusion. You can see here the AC occlusion. In fact, Abak, we thought that this is a complication from the procedure, Abak, which is somehow common complication, Abak, that you can cause Abak embolization to a different territorial artery, Abak, by Abak your instruments. So we went and we did our recanalization to the anterior cerebral artery and we succeeded. You can see about this picture, about all the circulation is open, all the circulation is patent, the right middle cerebral artery, the right ACA, about we have a small stroke here in the left ACA about and about the left MCO, about is patent. The patient went intubated to the ICU, about this was in the dawn. Abak, on the next day, Abak, we were trying Abak to extubate the patient, Abak, but our registrar found Abak, that the patient is having a right-sided weakness. Although Abak, the left side Abak, improved so much, the one Abak, we recanalized here, Abak, but she is having a left, Abak, a right side weakness. Abak, we did a follow-up CT brain, Abak, and we found Abak, that the patient is having a left MCA. Abak territorial, almost left or total left MC occlusion, and the patient Abak the right one Abak who we went Abak and do thrombectomy is normal, but the left one Abak has a big Abak infarction. So this raised the question Abak, what about Abak? It was obvious that this is AF and it was showering Abak from the cardiac source, Abak. So what about Abak the anticoagulation Abak with the TPA? Sometimes we feel this problem that we give the patient TPA, but we cannot give him anticoagulation in the first 24 hours. Abak, and this is does not prevent Abak further embolization if the patient is having a cardiac source. This is one of the difficult situations Abak we face Abak during mechanical thrombectomy. Another situation, this is a 48 years old male patient Abak with right MCA occlusion, which is evident here. We went and did the aspiration, but the patient is having an iatrogenic Abak dissection Abak in the internal carotid artery, which necessitates that we should put a stent Abak to seal this dissection. Abak, if I put a stent Abak, so this means that I should give the patient antiplatelet Abak because Abak the thrombogenicity of the stent is very high. But the patient received the TPA Abak, and so Abak we could not give him Abak antiplatelets. And this is another question and another problem we are facing Abak, if we are obliged during the procedure to give the patient antiplatelets. Abak, the same situation Abak is happening Abak in another example Abak, which is very common Abak in the Middle East area, like the Far East area, that we are having Abak an intracranial stenosis. So Abak underlying intracranial stenosis, the patient which have acute MCA occlusion on top of chronic Abak intracranial stenosis. Like this patient, this is an 82 years old female patient. She is old with left MCA occlusion Abak. And after we did the thrombectomy, we discovered Abak that the MCA Abak is having an underlying severe stenosis. Abak, you can see here Abak that we, after we did the thrombectomy and we wait for some time, it will reocclude, it will reocclude, it will reocclude. Abak, so Abak, the only Abak, only solution for this problem is to put an intracranial stent Abak to leave the patent, the artery patent. Here we give the patient Abak oral antiplatelet, which is ticagrelol Abak, and we were very afraid Abak the for the hemorrhagic transformation, but thanks God it doesn't happen. And on the next day Abak, we found the stent patent Abak, and there is only just a small infarction in the basal ganglia. The patient, the same problem Abak we are facing Abak is the IVTPA Abak when we give it in the patients with what we are calling tandem occlusion. Tandem occlusion Abak is an occlusion Abak of the extracranial part of the carotid aortic and the intracranial MC or carotid artery. In this many, many, most of these cases, we are obliged to open the middle cerebral artery and then put a stent in the internal carotid artery. Again, the same dilemma, the same problem that we are obliged to give the patient heavy doses of antiplatelet in such a situation, and the patient is receiving an IV tPA, which increases so much the risk of hemorrhagic manifestations in such a patients. All these situations, patient with AF or with dissection, a dilemma when they are receiving tPA before doing the procedure. What about the literature? There is a famous review article in the Journal of American Heart Association in January 2018 about the combining intravenous thrombolysis and antithrombotics in stroke. A study was conducted across the Dutch hospitals comparing intravenous thrombolysis with IV aspirin between 2008 and 2011. It was prematurely ended due to significant hemorrhage. So I don't have a question until now about if I'm obliged to put a stent in such a patient, how would I deal with in this situation? The other dilemma, the intravenous thrombolysis with heparinisation, there is not enough lectures in the literature until now. Although this is a guideline for the myocardial infarction patients, they prefer very much now to give IV thrombolysis ITPA with heparin. The only study in stroke was a pilot study which was done, showed that the risk of symptomatic hemorrhage was 8.4% versus 4% in patients with thrombolysis only, which is not statistically significant, but we are still afraid and still the guidelines do not do heparinization or give antiplatelet with IVTPA except after 24 hours. And these 24 hours put the patient under risk of reocclusion or the second line I would like to show today, or the second practical cases we are seeing in our practice, and sometimes we decline their presence, or we don't investigate the patients where are the item of the hemodynamic stroke. What about the hemodynamic stroke? Here, this raises in the context of thrombectomy, the emergency carotid revascularization without intracranial clot. Either this carotid revascularization is with a stent or bypass or surgical. What are the guidelines? Until now, we don't have guidelines because we don't have studies that study every peculiar case like the example we will be showing now. This is a 65 years old male patient who is having four different strokes within 1 week. The patient is experiencing stroke every 2 or 3 days. Every new insult. We did an MRA for this the patient, MRA brain and neck arteries, and we found that there is an occlusion of the extra. If we can have a look here on this MRA, well, we can find the following, that there is no cross filling from the right carotid system to the left carotid system because the patient is having a congenitally absent A1 segment on the anterior cerebral artery. And you can see here that his MC is patent, but there is a problem that this is a hemodynamic impairment. The MC is not filling as well like the right MC. It is not occluded, but it does not receive enough blood. So we proceeded for an MRI perfusion study, which found that there is a severe perfusion deficit in the side where there is a carotid occlusion. This was evident that the mean transient time and the time to peak in this side was more than 4 seconds. You know that if it is more than 6 seconds, this means that this hemisphere to left. This means that there is a severe perfusion deficit and that it is about to be infarcted. Let's have let's remind the circle of Willis that protects the brain, the collaterals to the brain. This is the internal carotid artery. You know that the circle of Willis is composed from the internal carotid artery, from the middle cerebral artery, the A1 segment of the anterior cerebral artery, the ACOM, the A1 segment of the other anterior cerebral artery, the internal carotid artery, the posterior communicating artery, which is the connection between the internal carotid and the posterior cerebral artery, what we call the P1 segment of the posterior cerebral artery, the basilar top of basilar artery, and the P1 segment of the other sides, and the PCOM. This is the constitution of the circle of Willis, which means that if I am having an internal carotid artery occlusion here and the circle of Willis is functioning well, the patient will have a cross-filling from the other side, or we will have a cross-filling from the posterior circulation. Sometimes we see patients with both internal carotid artery occlusions, and they are living well because the basilar artery is giving through the PCOM the two middle cerebral arteries. If you revise this famous figure, the complete circle of Willis is present just in 30% of the population. There is a lot of variations like this one, which consists 16%, or these two, which constitute with each other like one-fourth of the population. There's complete isolation between the anterior circulation and the posterior circulation. And this means that the patient like this, if he is having a problem in the basilar artery and it is occluded, he will die definitely. And we have a severe deficit because there is no cross-filling from the anterior circulation. But again, like this figure, this one does not have both PCOM. This one does not have a PCOM here and does not have a P1 segment here. And this is the other example. There is no PCOM here and there's no P1 here. These three figures, there is a complete isolation of the anterior circulation from the posterior circulation. But what about our patient we are talking today about? We can see this figure. There is a complete isolation of the internal carotid system from the other side at the posterior circulation. Because there is no A1 segment here and there is no PCOM segment here, it's extremely rare, but it's 1% of the population. And this is what happened to our patient exactly. We went to the angiography and we found that the patient imaging through the right carotid system, this is the right MCE, the right ACE, and there is no cross-filling to the other carotid system. This is our catheter in the left internal left common carotid, which revealed that there is complete occlusion of the left internal carotid. This is our catheter in the left vertebral artery, which revealed that there is no communication, which is the PCOM artery, from the basilar posterior cerebral artery to the internal carotid system. And this is the A anterior posterior view from the left internal left common carotid artery injection, which revealed very sluggish flow in the internal carotid system and the left MCE, you can see here, which is coming from the ophthalmic artery, which is very small in diameter, so that the patient is living only, or his left carotid system is thriving through the left ophthalmic artery, the retrograde filling with its communication of collaterals with the external carotid artery. This patient was sent for revascularization. We have here two options, either to do hybrid technique, which is a combined technique between the carotid endarterectomy and opening the rest of the carotid with endovascular technique, or doing a superficial temporal artery, which is that one, bypass with the middle cerebral artery. Actually, the patient did this, the extracranial to intracranial bypass, and which was very successful with complete resolution of the patient's symptoms. I would like to share finally this slide, which shows the morbidity and mortality in every territorial occlusion. We can see here that the T carotid, which is the internal carotid, is 90%, 23%. You can see how much there is a chance for the patient with a carotid MCA occlusion, tandem occlusion, even basilar artery occlusion, to pass from the morbidity. But any patient with internal carotid artery hemodynamic impairment, his morbidity will be 100%. This is why we can we should all always focus for this entity, which are the hemodynamic strokes. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ahmed Elbassiouny, for your wonderful presentation. You're always embarrassing us with wonderful, fine data about thrombectomy and vascular management. Radiological versus clinical mismatch in patients for thrombectomy.
Yes. I prefer this radiological clinical mismatch, maybe even more than the perfusion studies. Actually, I feel comfortable if I take in general decision for the thrombectomy based on the diffusion flare clinical mismatch more than the perfusion studies. But this is my opinion. It's not the practice everywhere, but this is my opinion.
Okay, another question. What do you do for the COVID-19 patients?
Actually, I was speaking about, we did the cases about for the cases about for intervention for the COVID-19 patients. It was like an elective procedure, more or less, about for an aneurysm rupture or something like this, because of, especially aneurysm, because we have some time to do PCR. You know, here in Egypt, most of the hospitals are very strict about not to introduce the patient of COVID-19 back in the general hospitals. So this affects so much, especially in the public hospital, the thrombectomy in the COVID-19